Take that. Rewind it back.
First, we got to celebrate Lil Jon's birthday. Lil Jon's birthday was yesterday. Here we go. Chop FM.
This ain't no way. Say what? We got the dog in the house. Yeah.
Abby, I see you. What up, Ash?
Yeah.
Sean, what's good?
Start this thing, okay.
Say what?
It's a safety ladies in the house. Okay. Yeah. Start this thing.
Turn it up to start the show.
Ladies in the house. Let's go.
In the club with my homies. Trying to get a little VI. Down on the low key. She know I'm.
Cody, Andy, I see you.
Hey. I saw the shorty. She was
good. Put some smiley faces in the chat right now. Everyone coming in. Cheyenne, Kim. Smiley faces in the chat if you're happy to be here tonight.
She got heavy.
Chat.
Feeling like she's ready to blow.
By the way, tell your friends we're starting the show right now. More's up in here.
Yes. So I got up and followed her to the floor. She said, baby, let's go.
Here we go.
So now I say, yeah, yeah. When it got down, she said, come and get me. Yeah, yeah. I get so caught up. My girl, you do the best of all me. Yeah, yeah.
Bobby Stark was good.
It was all up for me, baby. Yeah, 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 yeah.
Here we go. It's Chop SM. Every Monday night, 9 p.m. Eastern time. By the way, if you feel like it, send a blast out right now. Let's get some family in here. Because I got to say, we're talking about wild in the workplace. The times work just got a little off the rails today. Something I know we can all relate to. Put a smiley face in the chat if you've had to smile through some nonsense at work right now. Ash Marie on the show tonight. More on the show tonight. Shoff FM, here we go. Let's warm up. Angela, star in the building. Just getting warmed up right quick. Chop FM. Here we go. Yesterday was Lil Jon's birthday. You know we gotta celebrate on Chop FM.
At HR.
Chop!
I thought this was very interesting. Before we get into the show, Joe Biden released his inaugural playlist, the music that's going to be like played through the inauguration. Dua Lipa made it. Levitating. It's on that list. You heard it here first on Chop FM. Zara, what's up, baby? I see you.
If you want to run away with me, I know a galaxy and I can take you for a ride. I had a premonition that we fell into a rhythm with.
Anyone else have a crush on Dua Lipa, or is it just me?
Glitter in the sky, glitter in my eyes, shining just the way I lie. If you're feeling like you need a little bit of company, you met me at the
wild in the workplace is the topic for today.
Me, I want you, baby. My sugar boo. I'm levitating. The Milky Way. We're renegading. Yeah, 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 yeah.
Okay.
You, moonlight, you're my starlight. I need you all night. Come on, dance with me. I'm levitating. You, moonlight, you're my starlight. I need you all night.
Oh my goodness, dude, did we make it okay? Did we make it? Everyone, hi. This is such a cool event. Such a great outing. I'm so excited. I took 2 weeks off of life to collect my marbles and figure out what things are going to be like for 2021. Buttons, what's up, baby? It's so good to see you. This is Tawny, what's up? Peace, Witch. So, I want to start by letting you know my whole studio has been redone since I saw you last on Chop FM, what, 2 weeks ago? So, if tonight's a total train wreck, guess what? We're gonna plow right into that wall together. And I'm cool with it. I'm super, super excited. We got Ash Marie on the show tonight. More, and I've been practicing his last name. Hang on. More. I did this on purpose. Okay, everyone get ready to point and laugh if I mess this up. More Mizora. Everyone says it wrong. It's not Miserables. It's not Misera Marbles, although marbles were my favorite toy growing up, hands down. More Mizorov is going to be on the show. But first, we got to get into a little bit of this entertainment news, because I like to start the show off every day by kind of setting the scene and letting everyone know exactly what's happening in our climate, because God knows it's crazy, but we try to highlight the fun stuff. We don't want to hear nonsense. This is Chop FM. Come on. You want to hear nonsense, you watch CNN. Every Monday night, 9 p.m. Eastern time, we do this. I do it every single weeknight, 7 p.m. to midnight, 94.7 Hits FM. That's right here, online, 94.7hits.com. But it's getting a little crazy. We all know the world's getting crazy, but we got anti-cancel culture people getting canceled. That's how this week is going. Do we have anyone from the Detroit area in the chat or Michigan at all, real quick? Give me a thumbs up if you're from Michigan. I know Detroit means I see you. This is for my fellow Detroit people. You're going to appreciate this, too, if you're from elsewhere. So Detroit Free Press writer, his last name is Marlo. We're just going to call him Marlo. He is the person who writes for the Free Press, who is constantly trying to cancel people. He's dug up tweets, dug up old social media, old websites, old things that, you know, probably report cards that these people have had, and tried to get them canceled. Most recently, Marlo wrote an article about the new Detroit Lions head coach. I think his name is Dan, to be honest. I don't really watch sports. I just don't. But he recently wrote an article about this new head coach who came into Detroit just last week, and he was posting all these old tweets, literally from like 2007, where allegedly this guy was making homophobic remarks on Twitter, the new Detroit Lions head coach. So he wrote this article, new Detroit Lions head coach, homophobic, yada, yada. Jillian, thank you so much. I see you. This clown who writes for the Detroit Free Press, which, if you don't know, the Detroit Free Press is essentially like the most prestigious media outlet in Detroit. It's like the New York Times of the Detroit market. People found, get this, homophobic remarks that he posted not that long ago. They were able to dig him up from his Twitter. And this was literally less than 2 days after he wrote this article trying to shame the new Detroit Lions head coach. Buns, I see you with the love. Thank you so much, baby. I appreciate you. Andrew, what's good, Sue? So this guy is just a total clown. It's so funny watching all of Detroit social media just like totally shame him today. and I got to say, I hate to say it's funny, because I hate like laughing at some, or I hate like, you know, making fun of someone when they're down. It's just like so harsh, but I hate to say it, but you deserve this one, my guy. You definitely walked right into this one, Marlo. So kudos to you for that. This inauguration coming up this Wednesday. If you have been thinking about taking a social media detox day, listen, never been a better time than this Wednesday to take a day or two away from social media if you need it. I did it 2 weeks ago for my birthday. I had my birthday just not long ago. I turned 26. I know I'm so old now. During that time, I literally didn't touch my phone for 3 days, and it was absolutely the best experience of my life. And I just have a feeling tensions are going to be really high with this election. So if you've been feeling like you need that break, take it. You deserve it. And with those changes happening, some crazy stuff happening as Trump is leaving office. He's expected to pardon Lil Wayne. Now, if you remember a couple of weeks ago on Chuff FM, at the beginning of the show during entertainment news, which is this segment that we're doing right now, we talked about how Lil Wayne got charged with a gold-plated firearm after exiting a private jet a few weeks ago. Now, as you may know or may not know, if you are a felon in America, you're not allowed to carry a firearm. That's strictly prohibited. Rob, thank you. And Lil Wayne was caught with one. It's expected that Donald Trump is going to be pardoning Lil Wayne. Is that fair? Is it fair? What do you think? Comments. Yes, no. Should Lil Wayne be pardoned? Because listen, I'm not normally one for pardoning people. I'm not. But it's Lil Wayne. It's Lil Wayne. He gave us Lollipop. He gave us Rainbows, not really. He didn't give us rainbows, but he gave us a rainbow perspective on life. The man did great things for us in our childhood, and he has had such a great impact on culture. Let the man protect himself with a weapon, in my opinion, okay? Okay, that's just my opinion. I'm just saying, yeah, fireman, exactly. Kai knows. So that's a very interesting thing that might be happening. In light of the inauguration, which again, you know, you should avoid your phone if you can, that'd be awesome. Garth Brooks announced he's going to be performing at the inauguration, which is super, super exciting. He went out and said that it's not a political statement. It is a symbol of unity, which obviously, you know, with how divided our world is right now, we need as much unity as we can get. What's up, Katie? Good to see you. So shout out to Garth Brooks for that. All right, last bit of entertainment news before we bring my girl Ash Marie into the chat to talk a little bit about what got wild in her workplace. And I'll give you a hint. She works in a nursing home or worked in a nursing home. So we'll talk about that in just a second. This one hit me like a ton of bricks today. Now, with all due respect, because these are great and talented artists, when I think of bland artists, and this is my opinion. This is not fact. This is my opinion, which in my world is fact. I think Taylor Swift and I think Shawn Mendes and I think Harry Styles are the three blandest artists of our generation. I'm going to make that claim right now. Swifties, I'm sorry. Don't show up at my house. I like these artists. I watched the Shawn Mendes documentary. I've seen all of them in concert. However, I just think they're the three most unseasoned, bland, boring artists that exist. And that's not that saying they're not talented. Obviously, they're talented. Anyway. When I think of Chipotle, the restaurant, you know, build your own bowls, build your own burritos. I think of flavor. I think of spunky. I think of out there. Chris, thank you for the otter. I think of otters. I think of great things. Now tell me why the most unseasoned pop star in our generation has his own bowl at Flavor Country Chipotle. It's official. He officially has his own Shawn Mendes bowl at Chipotle. I don't even understand how this is legal, to be honest. I don't understand what in the right light. What, you couldn't have picked Bad Bunny? You couldn't have picked the Cardi B bowl? You couldn't have picked Big Sean? You pick Shawn Mendes to represent the cilantro, lime, cauliflower, rice, black bean, chicken, roasted chili corn salsa, romaine lettuce, and guacamole greatness that is that bowl. I mean, I'm just saying, Reggie, thank you. I'm just saying, yeah, I agree with Katie. It's not spicy. It's not spicy at all. I love Shawn Mendes, but I got to say, in my opinion, whack move by Chipotle, but guess what? That's why I do radio and not curate menus, okay? That's why we're here on Chauff FM every single Monday night at 9 p.m. Eastern time. Right here on Meet Me Scout, Plenty of Fish, and of course, 94.7 Hits FM. Goodness gracious. I can't believe we even have to talk about that, to be honest. So, you know, a lot of crazy stuff happens when you work at Chipotle, I'm sure. I mean, wrong orders, people freaking out because you charge $16 for guacamole. Like, I can only imagine the craziness that unfolds for the average Chipotle worker. I couldn't fathom it personally. But that's one job that I would probably pick any day over working in a nursing home like Ash Marie does. Katie, thank you. Ash Marie, if you want to go ahead and request the box right now, this girl, everyone knows her. She's a gem. She is a huge asset to the app, an absolutely phenomenal streamer. This one happened totally naturally. Sometimes I will think of a topic and I'll be like, this person would be perfect for it. This one was like, Ash and I were kind of talking on stream the other day, and we got the brilliant idea for her to come on to talk about this topic, Wild in the Workplace, on Chauff FM.
Hi. Hi, Chauff.
Ash is up. How are you?
I am nervous. I'm good.
Why are you nervous?
I don't know. I don't really do shows, but I'm excited. Listen.
I'm not Chris. You don't have to wear a suit, okay?
Oh, my God, right?
We're just hanging out. We're just hanging out.
That's true.
So tell me something good. What's the best part about your day before we dive into these Wild in the Workplace stories?
Oh, the best part of my day is I got an ice dragon. My third ice dragon. So that would have to be the best part about my day.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, it was pretty awesome.
I've never, ever gotten one. Ever. So I'm living really? Vicariously through you right now.
Well, I'm about to, you're about to live through the nursing home life too.
I can, it's funny. The second you walked in here, all of a sudden I kind of could smell it a little bit. No offense or anything like that. I know the vibe of the nursing home smells so well.
Yeah. And I mean, I wasn't a nurse. I was like the aide of a nurse. So I had all the dirty work.
I was going to say that's like D2, right? That's like step down from.
Oh, I was like, there's everybody and then there's us. So yeah.
Oh my goodness. So how did you even get lined up with a job in a nursing home?
So I had a friend, and she, obviously everybody knows that nursing homes are super understaffed. So she wanted me to come work with her because obviously she needed the help. And she's like, listen, take this 2-week class. All you have to do is work Friday, Saturday, Sunday, 12-hour shifts, and we get to work together. And I'm like, you know what? That sounds awesome. So I took the classes and, I passed, and then I started working with her. Like, they hired me on the spot. Like, I walked in and they were like, you're hired. You got it. And I was like, oh, cool. Now I know why.
Oh, snap.
I know. It is shady. But at the first, I'm just like, oh, I got the job. I must be awesome.
I was going to say, I'm pretty sure, like, when I was in college, I worked at Jimmy John's, and I'm pretty sure my Jimmy John's interview was more extensive than the one you just described to me.
Yeah. They pretty much just like, hey, they were like, did you pass your test? Did you get your certificate? I was like, yeah. They're like, great. You get to start this weekend.
They don't even look at it. They're like, all right,
they
you
don't
got
look
it.
At anything. They don't care about anything.
All right. They so you get in, right?
Yep.
Walk me through like your first thoughts.
Oh, okay. So at first I was like, this is going to be great. Like, I get to work with my best friend. And obviously, so let me start here. So the place I worked at was a nursing home, but it was more of a rehabilitation center. So you would think like you're going to walk into like all these older people. No, this was 18 and up. So you had like, I literally had like people that were maybe in accidents, like recovering drug addicts. Like, there was people my age. It was all kinds of people.
Oh my gosh. This is like not the nursing home I was expecting you to talk about.
It's not. It was more like, I don't know how to explain it. It was a crazy place.
Wow.
Hot topic. It is a hot topic. So my first day, my friend was like, well, you need to come with me. We have to go work on this person. And I don't know like if like how graphic this is, but this is just like, I'm going to be real here. I literally walked in and there was just feces all over the floor. And I said, okay, this is great.
Day one? Day one?
Day one. Day one. And when I say like, it was everywhere. I literally was like, okay, I can get through this. What a crappy day.
They always give the job like that to the new person, right? Like,
oh, yeah.
When you're in the grocery store and you hear like, clean up on aisle 7 and like 40 liquor bottles fell and broke. It's like, hey, this guy starts today. Hey, new guy. You're on aisle 7.
Yeah, they're like, hey, go in that room and fix that up. I'm like, wow, okay, like, this is great.
Oh, my God.
But that's not even, like, the worst of it, really.
Yeah, so how long were you there in total?
Okay, so I want to say a year and a half, but I literally would put my 2 weeks in, and then they would beg me to come back because they never had anybody, and I, like, knew all the residents, so I'd always go back, and then I just got to the point where I left.
Oh,
but
for real?
So about a year and a half.
Wow. Okay. So brought up the topic while in the workplace, like walk me through the first wild moment you had there.
Okay. Do you want to start with like the people that work there, or do you want to start with the resident?
Real quick chat. What do you think? Residents or employees? I don't know. I mean, these both just sound equally as spicy. I could truthfully go either way with it.
Employees. Okay.
Employees. So, right. Ease it in with the employees.
Okay, so I don't really have too many stories about the employees. We did have a nurse that worked there, and I worked with her a lot on the weekends. The one time me and my friend were just like, we got all of our work done, and this nurse, I don't think she's a nurse anymore. She literally comes up to us and starts talking to us. I'm like, okay, like she's nice. And then all of a sudden she's like, I have Xanax if you guys want to buy some. And we said, no, thank you.
Oh my God, what? Trying to give you drugs and sleeping drugs. Yes. That.
Yeah, and we were just like, oh no thanks, like we're good, like thank you though. Yeah,
wait, this is how long after you worked there?
I want to say 3 months.
Oh my god.
But she was like a new nurse, so I don't even know why she even felt comfortable enough to do. No way. I don't think she's a nurse anymore.
That's like really scary when you think about it, cuz
it is.
I've heard that like Xanax is one of those drugs that makes you like really forgetful.
Yep.
And it's like, I imagine, you know, being essentially a caretaker or a caregiver for a lot of people like that, it's like, you got to be on your game. Like, you can't forget to give, you know, Betsy her medicine at 7 p.m. Like, she'll die.
Yeah. Oh, no, exactly. Oh, yeah. She was a character. But I also think that she's not a nurse anymore because she was also stealing meds out of the carts. So she would like write down that she gave the meds and then she never really gave them. So.
Yo, Ash, can we go full conspiracy really quick? Because I have a theory.
All right, what's that?
I think when she asked you if you wanted the drugs, she was going to give you the drugs and then snitch on you for having the drugs. So then it would look like you stole the drugs and then she would just steal more drugs. And
yeah,
and
I can see that. Oh, for sure.
I feel like it was set.
Absolutely. I don't put anything past that place. I'm actually just talking. This is just a particular place I'm talking about. The other nursing homes I worked at, I didn't have these issues. Okay. It was so unorganized that the nurses would have us do the jobs that we're not supposed to. Like, okay, so if you work in a nursing home and you're a nurse's aide, like if we're being technical, I'm not even allowed to turn on the oxygen tanks. We're not allowed to do that because it's distributing, you know. So they would let us do that. They would give us medicine, say, go take it. Like they did. It was all bad.
You're just breaking rules of your own job.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God.
All the time. That's why I quit. That's why I left.
That's the one thing that's like really, I feel like it's easy to get worked into, especially in our society, is like people always want more from you when it comes to the workplace, right? So it's like they're always going to ask you things in the moment. Not always, but a lot of the time it's like, you know, whether that be like to work overtime for like not extra pay or like, you know, to do things that are kind of outside of your caliber of employment.
Yep.
I feel like that's something that our generation like struggles with so much, is just kind of like almost getting like taken advantage of a little bit in every single job that we have. It's something I'm like really learning. Like at my job, I recently started a new job a few weeks ago doing social media for a couple companies. And I just like, I'm learning there's moments like you just have to say no. Like if it's like too much or like it's not, you're something you're not comfortable with, like you got to say no.
I have to agree, especially if you work in a nursing home, you got to learn how to stay home.
I was going
to
say, yeah, you might be protecting your employer from some kind of nasty lawsuit if you say no in your situation.
Yeah. And honestly, if these nurses got caught and blamed us, I would have like, they would have took my certificate away. So, you know, and not just that, it's just dangerous for the residents. So,
yeah. All right. So now that we know these unfortunate, resident employees are on Xanax at work. Tell us about the employer, the patients that they give care to.
So I do have one more thing to say about the people that the employers. Yeah. So there's I used to work Friday, Saturday, Sunday, 12-hour shifts. I didn't work during the week. Obviously, I had my kids. I have 3 kids, if people don't know. And the one time I get a phone call and they're like, we really, really need somebody. And I'm like, well, I can't. I have my kids. And they said, you can bring your kids with you. And I said, absolutely not.
What? To the nursing home?
Yep.
What would you do with your kids?
And you guys, and once I tell you about the resident stories, then you'll understand why I didn't bring my kids. Daycare center.
They might. I mean, to be honest, though, like the kids might kind of bring people joy. You know, those people don't often get to.
Not this place. You can't bring this place joy. Mm-mm.
No, it's impossible.
We had a lot of psych patients.
Oh, I got you. Yeah. Yeah, that definitely makes it a little more difficult then. And maybe something you don't want your kids around anyway, too.
No. So going into the residence, this is probably like the one I remember the most. So we had a woman there. She was about, I want to say 32, 33. She had came from the psych ward. And usually she was pretty laid back and she lost it. She started breaking glass everywhere. She started freaking out. And then I'm trying to follow her so she doesn't like hurt anybody. And you know, like the phones that like are on the walls, this woman is strong. I don't know. She grabbed it off the wall and threw it at my head. Luckily I like ducked and the lady behind me ducked, which was a kitchen lady. And it was the scariest thing. ever.
Oh, what do you even do in that situation? Like, you guys have security, like, equipped to deal with that sort of thing?
No, no. We ended up, so she ended up actually, after she had that freak out, she left and I locked all the doors. We locked the doors.
She walked out, like, in that state?
She left and started walking down the street. The police picked her up.
Okay.
And then we said, you can't come back here. And honestly, my first thought was, she's going to go smash the windows of my car. But then she did.
Yeah, hopefully she doesn't know where you drive, right?
Yeah, I think they do, because, like, they'd be looking out the windows. They're bored.
They, like, have your whole life memorized.
Probably.
Yo, that's, like, terrifying. That's one thing I will say is, like, when people... like, especially when people are in that state and they don't know their own strength, right? It's like, you could be in, like, serious harm's way.
Absolutely. Ugh. I mean, my biggest thing was making sure all the other residents weren't going to get hurt, but she was trying to come after us. She wanted to fight us. I'll tell you that. But that's why I wouldn't bring my kids there. That's why I wouldn't bring my kids there. It's like that.
Wow. I got to say, that's a crazy, like, nursing home story. I remember, like, I used to have to go to the nursing home to visit my grandma when she got to her older age. There was literally nothing like that. The only closest thing was, like, this lady would panhandle, like, it was like downtown Detroit after, like, a baseball game or something. Like, she'd be sitting there, like, as you walk by, like, come here, like, trying to reel in every single person that walked by, and you have to like do one of these so she doesn't grab you.
We didn't really have a lot of older people in it, but I wish.
So what else did you have to deal with there?
Okay, so then only I have a few more, but I guess this one would be the on the cake. So I guess, like, it's kind of like the place that if your insurance, like, if we accept you with your insurance, they take you. So we had a lot of recovering drug addicts, and we had a woman that was 26, and I thought she was doing really well. She communicated with us and stuff. So we walk in. I'm trying to, like, walk in, like, I'm trying to check on her, and pretty much, let's just say she was in her bathroom and she had her spoon and she was doing drugs in the bathroom.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. While she's in care.
Yep.
And what Typical. Do you do in that? What do you do in that situation? Like, what?
Well, I instantly just went to the nurses and, like, said, this is your problem. Like, I'm not about to go take that spoon off her. Like, I don't know what you want me to do. I'm not. And they're the ones who, like, handled it, and, you know.
Wow. You know what you should have done? You should have put on some heavy metal and just let her rock out. No, I'm just kidding. You shouldn't have done that. Ebony, thank you for the castle. Wow. That's like, it's so hard to, like, teach people to do what's good for themselves. And I think when you add not only a layer of, you know, mental struggles, but also a layer of isolation on top of that they're experiencing in those homes.
That's true.
It's so tough. You know what I mean?
It is. And I try to explain to them, like, when I went and got my certificate, I was taught how to take care of somebody. I was like, I can't take care of someone that has a drug problem. I'm not certified for that. You know, I'm like, I'm not certified to deal with, like, I can't, the girl that threw the phone at me, I can't take her and, like, pull her down and, like.
No, like, yeah, you need, like, security, like, tackle them to the ground.
Yeah.
You need your own law enforcement in the facility. Like, what?
Mm-hmm. I know. So pretty much the only thing I could tell you, there was a nurse that fell in love with one of the residents. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that happened. And I had a resident that bit me. They were about the same age.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, she lost her job.
What'd you say? She lost her job?
Yeah, she did lose her job.
Of course she did. You can't do that.
Little nursing home romance.
Oh, my gosh. See, it's funny how that's illegal in nursing homes, but, like, if you were working at a restaurant and you wanted to date one of your customers, like, it's fine, right?
Yeah, no, I know. Well, I guess the issue, I mean, I don't know. I guess the issue was is that they were talking while he was in the nursing home. So.
Oh, okay. So I wanted to ask you, I hear this is a problem in nursing homes, and, like, I've never been close enough to really be able to confirm or deny it, but, like, is it, like, a thing with residents, like, having sex with each other? Like, is that pretty common?
Yes, it does happen. In the nursing home I worked at, obviously they're not mentally able. If they're both mentally okay and they want to have sex, yes. If I were to walk in and, like, two of them, like, two people were having sex and I knew that they were allowed, I'd have to just shut the door.
Oh, okay.
But if I know that they're not there, then I'd have to stop it or like go get somebody. Also, if you guys didn't know this, if you are in a nursing home and let's just say you have like, I don't know, your grandmother or grandfather's there and they still like to drink, they can get their okay from their doctor to actually have drinks at the nursing home.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know they
can still have their beer, you know?
My grandma would have loved to have bourbon in the nursing home. No one told her that. Not fair. That's crazy. I didn't realize like there's times that you're allowed to have sex and not allowed to have sex based on your mental state in the nursing home. I thought it was just strictly forbidden.
Nope, it's not.
Wow.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy.
Ash Marie walking in on two people and having to stop it. Oh my goodness.
Luckily, I didn't have to deal with that. There was a married couple that was in the nursing home I worked in. And like 1 minute they loved each other and the next minute they hated each other. So they had to separate them. So I didn't have to worry about that.
And the whole entire nursing home has to deal with their drama, right?
All the time. All the time.
They're getting it off their chest to like other people in the home and stuff. Mm-hmm.
Well, she used to go in his bedroom. Like, obviously she's not supposed to, she's not allowed to, but she would go in his bedroom and steal his clothes and bring them to her. I'm like, it's a lot to deal with.
Yeah, that is a lot to deal with. That could get bad too. For some reason, I just thought of Breaking Bad where there's like the bomb that goes off in the nursing home, but let's just like close that in a vault and like not open that idea.
Well, I mean, other than that, I've been bit by a resident and scratched and I've had been spit at, but other than that, that's pretty much it.
You've been bit. All right. Before we get to the end of this and we bring more in, I want to hear a little bit about that. Cause that when you think of wild in the workplace, I think definitely getting bit by a patient as a medical care worker is like probably top of the list.
Yeah. So I had a resident, she was super, super feisty. And she didn't walk. So we had to like, you know, lay her down. And I had my friend in there. He was helping me. He came in from night shift and she just started freaking out and she scratched me, she bit me, and then she spit at me. And the thing about it is you literally like so badly, I wanted to freak out, but I was just patient. I stepped back and I left and he had to finish her by herself. I just took a deep breath. I left. I instantly told like them what happened. They checked me out and then I wanted to freak out, but I didn't. I had to be so patient.
Yeah, I don't know what I would. I would definitely get a shower like as soon as possible, but I don't know what else I would do.
I didn't talk to her. I refused to work on her. I had to have other residents, and then she ended up saying sorry to me. And then
that was nice. Hopefully she said it from 12 feet away. I would be like, stay away from me.
It was a lot.
Socially distanced situation for sure from there.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a crazy place. It does have its good sides, but not that place.
But you were lucky enough to get out before COVID hit, right?
Oh yeah. I couldn't even imagine working there right now.
No.
I couldn't.
No. It's like that would be like, you know, when you're building like a set of dominoes and you accidentally bump the table and they all get knocked over before you're done. Like it would be that level tragedy.
It would be, yes, exactly that. Ugh. Exactly that.
Ugh. Ash Marie, I'm so glad you survived, and I'm so glad you're willing to come and share these ridiculous stories on the show.
Yeah, thank you. This was nice, so I appreciate you.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll have you back on again sometime.
All right, good. Do
I
exit?
I love you, Ash.
Yo, I love you, Joff.
Thank you so much. You're awesome. And Ash, put some in the comments so anyone who isn't following you can follow you, favorite you, even though I'm sure everyone already is, because Ash is a freaking gem of a human who does not deserve to be spit at or bitten or any of that other mean stuff that those residents did to her. My girl, Jilly, thank you. Sean, what's good? You're one and only. I see you. Chris, put a smiley face in the chat if you're hanging out with me right now. This is Choff FM. Every single Monday night at 9 p.m. Eastern time, we do this. So this is radio on the app. And what that means is we bring up topics every single week. We bring on callers. We talk about what's happening in the news, not the bad stuff, just the interesting, cool stuff. We do all kinds of spicy stuff every single Monday night, not only on this app that you're tuning in on, Meet Me, Scout, Plenty of Fish, or any of the other fantastic affiliates. but also live on 94.7 Hits FM in Montreal, which if you ever like going about your week and you're like, oh, I miss Choff. Why can't I hang out with Choff right now? Well, guess what? Every single weeknight, I do a live radio show on 94.7 Hits FM in Montreal. It's kind of like this show, but we play a little bit more music during that. So you can check that out there any day of the week, 7 p.m. to midnight I'm on. And the link to listen is in my bio. Or if you're in Montreal, just tune in your radio to 94.7. And there you go. I'm Choff. And if we're not connected on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, Snapchat, whatever, follow me right now. Pull up Instagram. Type in Meet Choff. Follow that account. Then click Hey Choff, which is in the bio. Follow that account. That way we can stay connected. I'll follow you back when I'm done with the show. And that's just a really good way for us to stay in touch. And I also do some teases for the show on there. I also am always open to feedback. So if you ever want to DM me a story or you want to get maybe featured on the show yourself because you have something very interesting to share, my DMs are open on Instagram at Meet Choff. Without further ado, before we get into more, I want to tell you, you got to stick around till the end of the show because we got some callers live from the radio that we're going to get to talking about some of their interesting workplace situations. And also, I've got some responses from our Instagram comments that we put up earlier about bad workplace stories. And also, I used to work in a strip club as a DJ. And before that, I've been a DJ for 10 years, as well as worked a bunch of other crazy, weird jobs. So I have some interesting stories to myself that I'm going to share more. If you want to go ahead and request the box, we will bring you on in here. Promise what's good. Thank you all for hanging out. Poppy Stark, Jesse, Chris Casper, Momo, Allie, I see you all. And more request that box I see right there. And I got to give a real quick shout out before we get to more to the gifters, Ebony, Katie, Gabby, Silly Jilly, the top four right now. Thank you for that love. I appreciate that. I see each and every one of you. So just know that I'm ever so grateful for everything. Johnny, I appreciate you too. More in the box right here. Wild in the Workplace on Choff FM.
Good, man.
Life is good. Oh my gosh, Moore, look at you right now. Look at you right now. Wait. Hang on. Hang on, Moore. We got a match for this, right? We got to do it.
Yes.
We got a match. Moore was such a gem as to buy one of the comfiest hoodies ever. The Smile Enthusiast hoodie, does it hold up? Is it the company's hoodie?
Oh, yeah, it's amazing. And, guys, amazing Smile Enthusiast graphics on the back.
And you can always
say, awesome. You can always I love it.
Smiling with the smile on the sleeve. There's still a couple sizes left. Heychoff.com/shop. That's also available in the link in my bio on my Heychoff Instagram. More. How are you, man? Tell me the best thing about your day.
I don't know how I'm going to follow that. I've never been bit at work before. I mean, so I don't know how to follow that.
You haven't been bit at work thus far.
Thus far. That's right. There's always tomorrow. The best thing I had today off, MLK, you know, birthday shout out. So, I had today off. So I went out and I got some tacos. And so, yeah, it's a pretty good day. Tacos were the highlight of my day. Tacos will always be the highlight of my day if I have tacos.
I feel like the tacos are the highlight of any day ever. And if anyone has anything to say about that, they're just wrong, right?
Especially if you come to Texas, man. Texas, we got some really bomb-ass tacos. So.
What makes them so good down there?
Dude, I swear there are some places that are so good you'll think you're in Mexico. I mean,
really?
Very authentic. I don't go for that. I'm probably going to put my foot in my mouth. I don't go for that like kind of bougie, like really, really white people kind of tacos. I like those authentic, like really authentic hole in the wall tacos. You know, this place is like just really, 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 really good.
Ash, thank you. Yeah, no, I feel that. Ash, thank you for that 3.9, by the way. I see you. I feel that on the tacos thing. Here's my thing, though. I'm the same way. I love the really good tacos, but I'm also really like, I love efficiency. So like if there's a Taco Bell and then there's no line there, but then there's a line at the place where the good tacos are at, I'm gonna choose Taco Bell every single time, right?
I'm a guest on your show, Choff. So I'm not gonna say anything about that opinion. I'm just gonna...
No, say it. Roast me.
No, it's not. I you know I don't do roasting. I just say that they're crunchy. They're crunchy meat shells. They're not tacos. I mean, it's okay. It's fine. They're still good.
Oh, I love it. Well, neither of us work at a taco place, believe it or not. We're talking wild in the workplace tonight on Chof FM. And Moore is like a legend of the workplace, because when I think of the top 10 jobs that I could not do in my entire life, Moore, I'll tell you what, I think law enforcement might be at the top of that list.
Yeah,
it might be. And Moore is in law enforcement. So like, tell me a little bit about that. What got you there? Tell me a little about your whole path getting onto that and what it's like for you.
I never thought, you know, as a young lad that I was going to be in law enforcement of any kind. I was like, no, that's definitely not for me. It was just a combination of things. I specifically work with in the juvenile justice system. So I don't deal with any kind of adult offenders or anything like that. I deal strictly with juvenile crimes. And, you know, ever since I graduated high school, man, I was working at a summer camp. In college, I worked at a residential treatment center for severely psychotic and behaviorally challenged youth. So wow. I've always just kind of had a heart for at-risk youth. And I really just believe in looking at people and not judging them by their worst mistakes. So I just felt like that was just kind of a natural fit for me.
That's amazing. I'm going to be honest. I'm very guilty of like almost always judging someone by their worst mistakes. And, you know, I would never want that of me, because when I think about my mistakes, I'm like, oh my God, why would anyone want to be friends with me if you really like rewind the tape? You know what I mean? So absolutely. I really look up to you for that. Like that's.
And if you think about it, right, like criminals, you know, we tend to see a criminal, right? And we think, well, this person is bad. We tend to not be able to see past their crime because they've been tagged with crime, whether it be robbery, theft, assault, or whatever. But a lot of these people, I mean, we get that from them because of the fact that they've been gone through the court system. They've been tried with this and they've been tagged with this crime. But I mean, how many of us have done things that honestly we probably could have been arrested for, or things that are just really, really bad? Would we want to someone to look at us and say, oh man, this is who you are. This mistake that you made, that's what you're about. So I think once you can kind of understand that, and think the more naturally you can accept that, the easier it is to work in law enforcement.
I totally agree. And, you know, just knowing you for the short time that I have on the app, you know, I very much feel like that echoes throughout your character. You know, you're very empathetic. You're very, you know, soft-spoken with people. You're very level-headed with things. That definitely echoes into your personal life too, as vital as it is for your professional life.
Appreciate that. Yeah.
Yeah, but I know, you know, even in a world where you're as empathetic as you can be, and you know, you really try to give everyone the benefit of the doubt, there's gonna be crazy things that happen when you're in that sort of a field. I got to imagine, right?
Yes. Oh my God. Right away. My first, I've worked in three different counties, and I'm not going to say that just for privacy reasons, which counties in Texas, but my very first job at my second county, they handed me this case of a kid who was sentenced to a residential treatment center. He had broken out of the residential treatment center, which I had been told was not possible because they had three different layers of, you know, security that they had to get past. But apparently while they were outside or recess or whatever they're doing, he broke out of this facility. He hitchhiked a ride. Then he hitchhiked into town, then stole a car. He stole a car, drove over, broke into a drug dealer's house, stole the drug dealer's drugs. And then ended up getting into a fight. And they said, he got picked up by the local police because he got in a fight with the drug dealers, who ended up finding him later on that night at a gas station while they were trying to resell the drugs that they had just stolen from the drug dealer. And this is all in a span of like 12, 14 hours. The officer who was previously working this case was the one that you replaced. So we just like to make some contacts and get this kid back and kind of sort all this out. And I'm like, well, that's a great first week.
Oh my, that's your first week on the job?
First week on the job.
I salute
you. They were nice enough not to assign me any more cases until the second week.
That's good. I was going to say, I salute this guy, because when I hear that agenda right there, I'm like, that's literally more than I've done in my life in the last week. And I don't just mean negative. I mean, more action in general.
It was an insane. That was one of the crazier things that happened to me. It was very interesting that it happened the very first week.
Wow. So how did you get the courage to go back into work after that? I would have been done. I would have been like, you know what? I'm going to be a lawyer. Bye, guys.
You know, it's funny. Before I answer that question, before I worked at in the field that I'm in, very briefly, I worked in child protective services. I realized it wasn't for me. It wasn't what I wanted to do. My very first case that I worked at CPS, I was shot at, like with a gun shot at, died. And it was, so after that, I realized very quickly after that, yeah, this is not for me. My very first case I got shot at, it may not be a good fit. I don't know if this is a sign from God, but I definitely don't think it was an indication of brighter things to come. But side note here, I want to let y'all know, this is a very funny thing. It has nothing to do with anything. But I called my mom the night that I got shot at. And I told her, you know, your only son, obviously, just got shot at in this case. I just wanted to let you know that about what happened and that we're at the police station now. Her response, and I'm not kidding, was, can I call you back? We're at the football game right now.
Did she hear what you had to say?
She heard me. I was like, Mom, did you hear me? I literally just got shot at. She's like, well, you're okay, right? And I'm like, I mean, technically, yes, but Mom, I just got shot at. She's like, well, the thing is, right, is we're at the high school football game now, and it's really, really loud. So maybe in about 2 hours, you could call us back.
I want to find like the Judge Judy music right now and get your mom on the show. Like, we need to have a trial. Like, what is going on?
Anytime I get in trouble with my mom, I just bring up that story. I was like, you know what, Mom? At least when I got shot at, you know, I've never told someone, well, can I call them back?
Can you get her on the phone right now?
Can you
call her?
No, she would be absolutely pissed.
I use
her Netflix account. Okay. I need to keep things.
You know what? You know why I really want to get her on the phone right now?
What's that?
Because I want to see if she'll actually take time to talk to me, or if she's gonna make me wait. Because if she made you wait, but she's gonna not make me wait, I'm telling you, more, you gotta go shopping for a new mom.
If we have time, maybe we'll give her a call at the end.
Stick around to find out.
Stick around. Will we call Moore's mom? Will we not? We'll just have to wait and see. But bringing this back full circle, I didn't really have a sense of fear or like kind of just like, oh my God, I can't handle this. After that situation, I was just kind of like, okay, well, it can't get much worse unless I actually, you know, get shot and it hits me. So it's really, I mean, how bad could it be from here?
And then it gets worse, right?
And then it gets worse, you know.
All right, so should we go into the details of how you got shot, or is it not that interesting?
It's actually a pretty funny story.
All right.
There's parts of it that are funny, and there are parts of it are tragic. I can give the short version. But the really, the funny part about it was the 911 call that I made.
Okay.
Because I'm going to summarize the story really, really quickly. Basically, we went out to respond to this allegation of abuse of a child. We went out there and we were told that the alleged perpetrator was not going to be at the home. But I knock on the door and he's there. And like I asked, well, hey, is your family there? Because you're not supposed to be around your family. He said, no, they're somewhere else. And it turns out that a woman comes from behind him holding a gun. And I'm like, I freeze because I wasn't scared. They say fight or flight, but there's another F called freeze. There's just nothing in my life had prepared me for this moment. Luckily, my coworker was, this is my first case, was, you know, she was shadowing me and she grabbed me and we ran. But that neighbor was his, I mean, that lady behind him was his neighbor who he had kidnapped that day and was doing things that I can't really repeat on the live. But anyway, so when we were running to the car, we heard a couple pops. But and luckily neither me or my coworker were hit, but because he had taken the gun from her when because the lady actually thought that we were there to help her when we answered the door.
Oh wow.
And she was basically saying, I have the gun, like, you know, come out and, you know, take it, we're good. So anyway, we ran away. But the funny part, which is that part was bad, but the funny part was the 911 call, because I called 911 once we got, we drove off, we got to a park about a few blocks down, and I was just hyperventilating. I couldn't really speak. I couldn't process my brain, and all I could get out, they're like, 911, what's your emergency? I'm like, there's been a gun. And she like, there's been a gun. I was like, yes, there has been a gun. And she's like, so I'm going to need you to explain to me what you're talking about. What does that mean? There has been a gun. So eventually she was able to redirect me. I'm like, lady, did you not hear me? I was just at some house and there has been a gun. So she got me back on track. We reported it, but yeah.
She's like, where are you from? Cuz
I wish I had the 911 call. Cause I got to assume that's the one.
I was going to say, how great would that be if we could have played that audio on Chopped FM? Right.
That would be awesome. They probably play it at the dispatch center when they need a good laugh. You know?
Allie says 911 says same as his mom. Hey, we're at the game. Can you just try calling again, get another operator?
I'll be back in a few hours.
Oh my God. Nightmare situation. All right. So this is before your first day in law enforcement and then your first day in law enforcement. I got to know, what happens next? Where does this go from here?
Before my last day in law enforcement, wait, say it again, rephrase.
So the shooting situation was before all you right. got in law enforcement.
Right.
The first day in law enforcement, you had this crazy situation that you mentioned earlier. Where does it go from here?
Well, you know, I've been very fortunate that I've just continued promoting and advancing in where I am. I see myself eventually in a more administrative leadership role, but I'm kind of still in the officer that role right now. But I do see I'm getting my master's degree, and I am like trying to get my ducks in a row to be in a more leadership role. But like, yeah, it's all about, you know, making a difference. We need people in law enforcement who, you know, don't look at it as us versus them, you know, because that's not the way it is. We're there for the community. We're all there to make the community a better place. So if you look at it, and unfortunately, I'll admit it, there are people in my field that look at it as I'm the good guy, you're the bad guy. And it's a battle, it's a war, right? But that's, and so it's a process of trying to change that mentality. And unfortunately, even in the more administrative leadership roles, you'll run into that from time to time.
Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely. That's a scary thing too, you know, because there's in any situation, like there is no definite good guy and definite bad guy. Like every situation is a give and take, and it's a balance of things. And it's definitely, you know, it's really important that people within that position, you know, have a similar perspective that you have, because ultimately, I mean, it's that empathy that really solves problems, I think. And it's that empathy that makes people feel not alone and not so scared.
Right.
So, you know, I respect you big time for that, man. I love it.
Absolutely.
You have any other crazy things happen to you in the field of law enforcement?
Oh yeah. I try when you invite me, so I tried to like narrow this down to like two or three, just because, I mean, I literally could just go on forever, but we had this situation. I wanted to share one of my success stories. If I could, we had a kid who, she came to me when she was 16. And she was addicted to meth, addicted to several other drugs. And when she reached 17, technically we can let her go because she's technically an adult in the state of Texas. We can't charge her with anything, even if she was to get in any more trouble. We had tried several things with her and nothing was working. We had tried putting her with an LCDC. It just wasn't working. She wasn't really interested in treatment. She wasn't going to school. So when she turned 17, several people above me were just kind of like, maybe we should just, you know, go ahead and cut her off, cut our losses, let her go. I didn't want to do that. I was still relatively new. I had been in there less than, you know, 4 years at the time. I was still relatively new. And I was like, I just didn't want to do that. And I quickly identified that the problem was that her issue was her access to her drugs, her substances. So like it would have been just easier to just let her go, say whatever. But I found her her grandmother who lived kind of out in the middle of the woods, who would be willing to take care of her, but she just didn't have the resources. So I reached out to community resource partners to get grandma's house set up to get her so she could provide for this 17-year-old girl. Because that was, I knew, was the only way that was going to get her away from these substances if she didn't have access to them. We were going to get her schooled at home. She was going to be, and to make a very, very, very long story short, We were able to get her sober for 6 months. She was able to get her GED. We paid, I went out of my way to find a grant so we could pay for her GED, paid for her college entry exams. And now she graduated college. She is the manager at a at-home healthcare company. And it's just been, and I just think back, like, what if I had just done what they wanted me to do and just cut her off and say, you know what, we cut our losses. But it just took a little bit of extra work to get her, you know, at a place where she needed to be, where she could be successful. And then the rest was up to her.
Wow. That really is wild in the workplace. Like, you changed this person's life.
You know, and it was a community effort, you know, because it wasn't just me, like, I'm going to save this child. But, you know, we reaching out with grant partners, you know, people writing, you know, emergency grants for this girl, getting the grandma's home fixed up, getting her food stamps so grandmother could provide, because she was on a fixed income. So it's all about that community. It's all about reaching out. It's all about, like I said, being on the same team. It's not us versus them. We're all in this together. We all want people to, even criminals, even offenders, we want them to be rehabilitated, not just so we can feel safer, but so that as a society, collectively, we can be stronger and healthier and better.
Yeah, no, and it's funny that you say that, because that's almost like a lot of the argument behind, or some people's argument behind the whole defund the police thing. It's like they don't want to necessarily take money away. They want to reinvest it into, you know, rehabilitative services like that to really help grow our communities, because, you know, we are hurting on so many levels right now. So
I don't want to speak anything about politics or anything, but I will just put some things in perspective in terms of, like, the war on drugs and stuff like that. The average, and I don't know if these numbers are exact, but they're pretty close. The average cost of a year of a residential treatment for, like drug recovery or substance abuse recovery is around $40,000 to $60,000. But the average prisoner, it costs $70,000 per year. So think about that. It costs more for someone to sit in a jail, sit in a prison cell for a year than it does to actual pay for stuff that could actually help them. So,
wow.
I mean, I'm not trying to make a statement about one way or the other what should be done politically, but it's just definitely food for thought.
No, yeah, I mean, that speaks volumes, man. That speaks volumes. That's wow. More, I'm so glad we had a little success story in there. I gotta say, I was expecting this to be all chaotic today. I'm like feeling a little bit filled up from that.
Well, thank you. I just realized now that I'm actually streaming from my actual phone, so I can't call mom right now.
Oh, all right. Well, next time we'll get mom on the show. How about that?
Next time. But thank you for having me. I very much appreciate it.
More, my pleasure. You're such an awesome human. I love your energy. I love the the way you make everyone feel so included. And you got a cool spark about you, man. I really appreciate you coming on and sharing a little bit of that with us on Trough FM today.
Anytime, Trough.
I agree with Poppy Stark. More for top, man. You the best, more. I appreciate you. For anyone new to the stream, Blair, I saw you sneak in. What up, girl? Thank you for the compliment. Cheyenne, welcome to the family. Thank you guys all for the favorites, the gifts. I see it all. Even if I don't mention it all, I really do appreciate it. Shout out to you, Jilly. So any new friends, if you haven't already, hit that star up top. Join our family. This is Trough FM. It's my live radio show that we do on the app. We bring the radio to the app. It's so futuristic, but also like kind of 90s, and it's kind of cool because of that. I'm Trough. What up, Juice Baby JoJo? She was on the last show that we did. I got a couple more things I want to get to today. I'm going to talk about my crazy in the workplace story. But first, I want to get to some Instagram reads. Now, I was a DJ for 10 years, by the way, so I'm going to just tell you one crazy story after we do this. JoJo, thank you, baby. I appreciate you. Everyone show JoJo love. That girl's got such great energy. I took a screenshot of this so I wouldn't forget. Actually, no, I wrote them down here. Wow. I'm double-checking my boxes on Trough FM tonight. So every week on my Instagram, at Meet Trough, M-E-E-T-C-H-O-F-F. JoJo, thank you. Calls are going to be at the end, Andrew. Don't worry. I put up a little kind of like a questions thing where you can respond. Today we did that. You're wild in the workplace situations. Shout out to Robin. She does social work. She just had a client attack her. That's terrifying. And Robin, I just want to say on behalf of all them involved, thank you so much for your bravery. For real. It means a lot. Dar said that Dar lives in Iowa. Everyone knows Dar. He said that they pulled the fire alarm at his work, and he actually had to stand outside for over an hour. That's a bummer. DJ Eric G works in a nursing home just like Ash Marie, except the difference is he actually wipes the butts. He's the butt wiper. So shout out to Eric G. He's not only a great DJ and just an amazing person, he also wipes a good ass too. Shout out to you, Eric G. Shout out to Chris Dude on Instagram at Meat Chof. What did he say? Oh, he said he's got a very labor-intensive job. He said what makes it intense is just all the yelling and heavy lifting. I got to shout out my dude, Corey. He is a FedEx package handler. Yo, it's got to be a crazy, crazy time to be a package handler anywhere right now. Just with how crazy everything is and how many more people are ordering stuff online. Again, those Instagram reads every single week at Meet Choff, M-E-E-T-C-H-O-F-F. Follow me there if you need that spelled out for you. Just hit my bio and you can get it there. Before we get into the calls, which I got some live calls from the radio that we're going to get to, talking about their bad workplace situations. Real quick, I got to tell you, so I've been DJing for 10 years now. I've DJed in everything from weddings to drag shows to skate parks to strip clubs to nightclubs to massive concerts with almost 10,000 people. I've opened for some of my favorite artists of all time. And I will tell you one story that was probably the craziest night that I've ever had DJing. It was when I was in college. So for college, I went to Fair State University, which is, if you know, so Michigan is a state that's shaped like a hand, right? This is the state of Michigan. It's about, what, here-ish? So I was here at college. My freshman year, I was kind of new to DJing at the time, you know, only been doing it a couple years. And I'm DJing in this apartment party, right? And it's a pretty small apartment. You know, there's probably like, I would say maybe 40 or 50 people like sardined into this place, like sardined, like we're in close quarters in there. And I'm not on a sturdy table or anything. Like I said, this is early in my DJ days. I'm on a budget, right? So I'm on like a folding table or something. And I don't know what happened. I don't know what started this, but there were like two groups of kids. I think there were two different fraternities and they all started fighting, like brawling in this apartment, right? Brawling. Like, I didn't even know who was on whose side. I just saw punches getting thrown. And like, I'm just here. Like on the, first of all, I was at that stage of DJing where I'm like, I thought it was okay to like get, you know, have a lot of drinks and DJ. I did that a little bit growing up. I've since learned my lesson, but I was in that stage. So picture me, little old me, which by the way, if you don't know me, I'm 135 pounds and I'm about 5'11". So, you know, I could easily be squashed by someone if they wanted to squash me. I'm on the mic like, hey guys, stop fighting. Stop fighting. Stop it. As if I'm going to stop this. Right. And so someone ends up dragging these guys outside after they tried to fight me for trying to stop their fighting. Listen, all I wanted to do was keep the peace. Now, when this story got crazy is when one of these groups of dudes, they had a bunch of pickup trucks. Now these dudes go out into their pickup trucks. They come back to the party that I was DJing at with chainsaws in hand. I'm talking like six dudes with chainsaws. Why they got chainsaws? Why they were in their car at a college party? I don't know. But all I know is these people were trying to evacuate this party because it just got crazy out of nowhere. And all I hear outside is, yeah, come out here. And there's like, I literally just see like three dudes at this door with chainsaws, three dudes at this door with chainsaws. Literally, I like tore down all my gear, like sat behind the table and just like tried to get out of reach and just tried to really get into a position to where I would like not bug anyone. A lot of crazy times DJing. And I gotta say, I wouldn't have it any other way. I move that mic so you can see me. Before we end the show, let's get to some live calls from the radio. Choff FM, every single Monday night, 9 p.m. Eastern time. What about a coworker? You got a bad coworker? What's your bad coworker story?
So this woman was a night lead at a sandwich shop I worked at, and she called in about an hour before her shift started claiming that she had some mental health stuff going on. I said, all right, understandable, absolutely. I totally relate to that. So she didn't show up for her shift that day. She didn't show up the next day. Her husband called that following day after she initially reported everything to say that she didn't feel like leaving the couch and coming in to work. So she was hoping that we would supply her with unemployment if she was quote-unquote inpatient hospitalized for long enough that we would relieve her of job duties and she could collect unemployment.
I mean, that is about as 2020 as it gets, though, I will say. Collecting unemployment when you're not actually unemployed. I know a lot of people that did that this year, and I'm not going to name names because I know snitch. Bad coworker situation on Chalk.com.
I have a theory in life, and I've raised my kids to follow this idea that if you're really good at something, you don't have to tell anybody that you're good at it.
That's true.
See how good you are. And this coworker had to constantly say how good she was at everything, and she had to train me, so she was telling me how good she was. She was better than everybody else. Constantly.
So, so true, though. Like, hard work definitely speaks for itself. Volumes, too. Wild in the workplace was the topic today. Ash Marie, more miserable. I actually figured out how to say it. More miserable, my man. Wild in the workplace. We got time for a couple more stories. Let me hear yours.
One of my first jobs out of high school. So every day I would bring Hot Pockets to work. Hot Pockets was my thing, man. And every single day my little refrigerator would get raided for a Hot Pocket. And it turned out to be the janitor, dude.
Fire that janitor. I would rather eat my Hot Pocket and have crumbs all over the floor for days than have this janitor come in and eat my damn Hot Pockets. Are you kidding me? I'm a ham and cheese flavor, by the way. Don't judge me on that. Wild in the workplace on Chalk FM. Time for one more.
I was engaged at the time. I went and picked out my wedding dress, which I thought looked amazing on me. Brought the pictures on my phone to work, showed them to her, and she said, oh, it's so pretty. Do you have any plans to lose weight before your wedding?
Ooh! I will say, getting called fat by your coworker, I wouldn't be the worst person to get called fat by, right? You probably think of worse. At least it wasn't your husband, your future husband, that said that. We got time for one more. Wild in the workplace, that bad coworker situation.
There's actually two of them. The first day, which was like my first day of training, there were two of us working in this group home. We were doing home health care, and she fell asleep while she was supposed to be training me. And then the next day, when I was supposed to get trained my second day, she did the same thing.
Oh my God. Did the same thing? Fell asleep while training? You could have got a promotion.
Yes.
Like, what? That's what I would have done.
Absolutely.
Get that promotion. Sneak in there. Get that bread. You never know. You can move up quick. That happened to me at first day training. You fell asleep or your instructor fell asleep? Kyler, I appreciate you, bro. Much love to Captain Fishy, a.k.a. Kyler. Kelly Show, what's good? This is Chalk FM. Live every single Monday night, 9 p.m. Eastern time right here on Meet Me Scout POF and all the other great affiliate apps. Also live on 94.7 Hits FM in Montreal. If you're new to the stream, hi and welcome. I'm so glad you're here, for real. Thank you for being here. Like, I know you could be anywhere. You're choosing to spend your time with my weird ass. I appreciate that so much. And I want you to come back. I want you to feel like you're part of this family. Hit that star up top so we can stay in touch. Got to give a big shout out to everybody showing love in the stream today. Ebony, Ash Marie, Silly Jilly. Shout out to Eric for always unfollowing and unfavoriting and refavoriting. I appreciate you guys showing love, for real. More miserable. Thank you for coming on the show today. By the way, if anyone wants, you know, these super soft, super comfy, maybe the comfiest hoodie ever, the Chalk hoodie, the Smile Enthusiast hoodie that's going to help you smile big. Says it on the back, Smile Enthusiast. HeyChalk.com/shop. Still got a few sizes left on there. And there are a few vintage Chalky mugs. Hang on. The vintage Chalky mug also on the site. There's a couple. I think there's only like five of these left. So if you buy one of these, you're literally going to own a one of what? I think there's eight of these in existence. a Choffee mug. They're vintage, so you could get that. Heychoff.com/shop. But thank you so much for being here. For real, it means the absolute world that we get to do this. We get to hang out. This is like what I call my dream radio show. I tell people, they're like, what is the show? What is Choff FM? How do you label it? I label it literally as my dream radio show. Like, if I were given my own radio station to do whatever I wanted to do on, I would do exactly what I do here at Choff FM. And I do radio professionally too. 94.7 Hits FM every single weeknight, 7 p.m. to midnight. So right now, if you want to go on there, hang out with me, I'm going to still be talking on there until midnight. Captain Kyler, thank you. Poppy Star, thank you for being here. For real, it means the world. Jay, I love you. I appreciate you. John, back next week for more. Make sure you're following at Meechoff, at Heychoff, all socials. I love you. I want nothing but the best for you. Please do me a favor this week, okay? Just one favor for yourself. Do something a little extra. Whether that be, you know, maybe cleaning up your room really good for yourself, rearranging your furniture so you feel good. Maybe that's going and spoiling yourself on a good meal. Do me a favor and practice self-care just that much extra this week, just for me, okay? Just for me. Can we do that? Because I'm going to do it, and I want you to do it too. Otherwise, I'll have to do it alone. I don't want that. I want to do it with you. Uber Eats it is. John, send it to my house. Choff FM, I'm back next week. I love you so much. Right here. See you soon.